Grace and peace to you, and welcome to worship here at Trinity Presbyterian Church, whether you're watching us online or listening in on the radio. And if you're tuning in on a Sunday morning, this is our first in-person outdoor worship service. It starts at 9 o'clock in the morning, and we hope that you can join us when that's appropriate for you and your family. In the meantime, we will offer this online version, and it's a great way for us to stay connected in worship in these strange times. Also, this Sunday, we will be gathering as children and young families for games and food at 4 o'clock in the evening, and then the youth are invited up at 5:30 as we kick off our youth ministry church year. We hope to see you. And now let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship the living God.
Good morning. Hear the words of Jesus. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Now let us confess our sins to God, who forgives and saves. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, you lived for us, yet we have not lived for you. You have forgiven us, yet we have not forgiven others. You have loved us, yet we have not loved ourselves, nor have we loved one another. Take pity on us and forgive us, God. Help us to forgive. Help us to live for you. Help us to love through Christ our Lord. Amen. people of God, our sins are forgiven. God is merciful and gracious and is Lord of us all. Reconciled to the God who loves us, let us live in love through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God is good all the time, all the time. God is good. God is also strong, and he wants us to be strong. In fact, he made us some very well-made armor to help us. He gave us the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the spirit, sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, the belt of truth, the sandals of peace that helps us go around and tell the good news of Jesus, and last but not least, the helmet of salvation. Now, a Roman soldier would never go into battle without their helmet. And most of these helmets were made of thick leather with metal pieces sewn in, or just all metal that was molded to their heads. And most of them had metal pieces to protect their face. But the majority of the helmet protected their head. Paul assigns this as the helmet of salvation because he wants us to remind us that God has saved us. And we know from Romans 6:23 that salvation is a gift from God. So God has forgiven all of our mess ups, and we can worship and enjoy him here on earth today where we are. But we also will be able to worship and enjoy him forever and ever after we die. So God gives us the helmet of salvation to remind us that he has saved us. He has given us the shield of faith to remind us that he loves us. He has given us the breastplate of righteousness to remind us that he protects us. He gave us the sword of the Spirit to remind us that we can worship. He has equipped us to worship and enjoy him. And God holds us up with the belt of truth. He also gives us sandals so we can spread the good news of Jesus. After the worship service today, talk to your children about the gift of salvation. Tell them about a time that you worship God. Tell them about a time that you enjoyed God. And even though I have taken off those plastic pieces of armor, I am still wearing the armor of God, and so are you.
Let us pray. O God, who is our strength, you have protected us from those who would seek to oppress us. You have shielded us from those who would seek to destroy the good gifts you have put in us. Your love and power never fail. Thanks and praise to you, our safety and stronghold. We exalt you, O God, majestic in holiness, for there is none like you. Strengthen and guide us with your word. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. The first scripture reading is Psalm 105, 37 to 45. Now hear the word of the Lord. He brought out Israel, laden with silver and gold, and from among their tribes, no one faltered. Egypt was glad when they left, because dread of Israel had fallen on them. He spread out a cloud as a covering and a fire to give light at night. They asked, and he brought them quail and satisfied them with the bread of heaven. He opened the rock and water gushed out like a river. It flowed into the desert. For he remembered his holy promise given to his servant Abraham. He brought out his people with rejoicing, his chosen ones with shouts of joy. He gave them the lands of the nations, and they fell heir to what others had toiled for, that they might keep his precepts and observe his law. Praise the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
beginning a sermon series today that goes along with a little booklet that you got in the mail this week. And if you didn't get one for whatever reason, there are some extras in the church office. The booklet is entitled, God Will Use This for Good. And it's the story of Joseph, one of the main characters at the end of the book of Genesis. And I don't know of anyone in the Old Testament who has as many ups and downs as Joseph did. But God brought Joseph through it all and somehow used all the messiness and difficulty in Joseph's life for God's good purposes. And the promise is that what God did for Joseph, that God will do for you. We get introduced to Joseph in Genesis chapter 37 and beginning at verse 2. Hear God's word. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other children because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Once Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream that I dreamed. There we were binding sheaves in the field. Suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright. Then your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf." His brothers said to him, "Are you indeed to reign over us? Are you indeed to have dominion over us?" So they hated him even more because of his dreams and his words. He had another dream, and he told it to his brother, saying, "Look, I have had another dream. The sun, the moon, and the 11 stars were bowing down to me." But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said to him, "What kind of dream is this that you have had? Shall we indeed come, I and your mother and your brothers, and bow down to the ground before you?" So his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem, and Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock in Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." He answered, "Here am I." So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. He came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields. The man asked him, "What are you doing?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where are they pasturing the flock?" The man said, "They have gone away, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. It may be that you're watching today and everything in your life is going exactly the way that you want it to. Your career is skyrocketing. Your spouse thanks you each day for the privilege of being married to you. Your kids have agreed to bypass all the problems of adolescence and go straight from childhood to responsible adult status. It may be that all your habits, your home, your health, your finances are exactly the way that you want them to be. Maybe that's you, but maybe not. Maybe things have not turned out exactly the way that you planned. Maybe you're in danger of losing your marriage. Maybe you have a grown child or a sibling or a parent that you're out of relationship with. Maybe your job is at risk. Maybe it's just this season that we're in and you're feeling isolated or depressed or anxious. Or maybe it's something deeper. Maybe you feel like you have failed God in some way. If that's you, well, then this message that we're going to look at for the next 4 weeks is especially for you. And I'm so glad that you have tuned in this day. So we're looking at this character from the Bible that went through just about as many crises as anybody I know. His name is Joseph, and over the coming weeks, we'll see how things go from bad to worse. When we first meet Joseph, his trouble has not yet started. Things are going quite well. Genesis 37 says, Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Now, I know it's hard to think of a kid doing something like that to his brothers. Can you imagine a little brother being a tattletale? Well, of course we can. We don't know exactly what was going on. We don't know if the brothers had done some bad stuff or if Joseph was just making all this up. The wording in the passage is a little ambiguous. But one thing is clear, Joseph has some problems with his brothers, and he goes running to his dad to tell. But there's something even more critical going on here. The text says, now Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a long robe with sleeves. Now here the writer is telling us about the family dynamics that are at play. Joseph's father is Jacob. As you may know, Jacob had a wife named Rachel. She was lovely. She was his favorite. But then he had another wife named Leah, and she was clearly the second choice. Rachel couldn't have children, and Leah could. So one day Rachel said to Jacob, since I can't have children, you can have children through my maidservant Bilhah. Leah saw that. She thought, well, that's a good idea. So she said to Jacob, you can have children through my maidservant, Zilpah. Now, as you can imagine, things get really complicated. It's like reality TV. And what this means is that the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah are the lowest status in the family, while Joseph, on the other hand, is the number one son of the number one favorite wife. And so he's daddy's boy, and he makes his father's eyes light up when he walks in the room. Joseph's status is symbolized when his dad gives him a coat. And some of you will remember the old King James Bible says it's a coat of many colors. And when the brothers see Joseph wearing the coat, it just destroys them. It cuts them to the heart because of what it represents. The text says that when his brothers saw that their father loved Joseph more than any of them, they hated Joseph and could not speak a kind word to him. Another problem we see is that Joseph was a little slow to pick up on the tensions within the family. We are told one day that Joseph has a dream and he tells it to his brothers, and they hated him all the more. He said to them, listen to this dream I've had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it. Isn't that cool? Question, do you think Joseph's brothers were as happy about that dream as Joseph was? Do you think that they are excited for Joseph? Of course not. It's like, Joseph, if you have any social intelligence at all, you need to keep these dreams to yourself. But no, we read that Joseph had a second dream, and he told it to his brothers. Listen, he said, I had another dream, and this time the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to me. Isn't that neat? Hey, guys, don't you love these dreams? And finally, his brothers can't take it anymore. And one day they get Joseph off by himself. They kidnap him. They throw him in the pit. The plan is to kill him, but at the last minute, they decide to sell Joseph to a caravan to be taken down to Egypt as a slave. And the brothers take the coat. They cover it with an animal's blood, and they show it to their father to convince him that Joseph is dead. literally overnight, Joseph has lost his status, lost his home, lost his parents, lost his financial resources, lost his future occupation, lost his culture, lost his friends, lost everything. Before this, if he had a problem, if things got shaky, he could turn to his dad who had wealth and power and resources, but now where is his security going to come from? Before this, if you were to ask Joseph who he was, he would have told you, I am the number one son of the number one wife, and I wear the coat to prove it. But now what's his identity? Before this, if you had asked him about his dreams, he would have said, I will be the greatest in my family. All will bow down before me. But now, what is his purpose? What are his dreams? See, what happened to Joseph is what happens to everybody one day. It has happened or will happen to everyone here. We all live with the illusion of security and identity and purpose. I'm secure because I have this money, because I have my health, because I have these abilities. I have identity because I have this job, I have this education, I have this resume, I have this degree. I have purpose because I'm constantly striving and achieving. I'm going to do more tomorrow and more the day after that. Until one day, these things are revealed to be the illusions that they are by a crisis that breaks through our normal lives. Maybe it's a financial crash, maybe someone that you love dies, maybe you go to the doctor's office and the body that you've just kind of taken for granted lets you down and there's a diagnosis. Maybe someone betrays you, maybe there's a scandal, maybe you lose your reputation. When a crisis comes and everything that you're counting on is gone, when all the stuff that we've been depending on evaporates, the question we generally ask is, why has this happened to me? And the answer is usually pretty complicated, and usually we don't get a very satisfying explanation. Often what we'll do at first is start blaming folks. And for Joseph, you can just pick one. It's his brother's fault. They hated him. They betrayed him. Or it's his dad's fault because his dad is the one that set up all this favoritism. He's the one that made a mess of the family. Or it's Joseph's own fault. Joseph reveled in being the favorite. He loved his privileged position and didn't seem to care a lick about anyone. Now, after trying to assign blame, you eventually come to the real question, the much more important consideration, which is, what do I have left when what I thought I could stand on is gone? When things fall apart, when the earth shifts under our feet, when there doesn't seem to be any solid ground, then what do you do? Then where do you stand? I thought I could stand on my relationships or my good intentions or my abilities or my job or my talent or my reputation, but then one day it's gone. And so what's left? That's really the question. The strangest thing happens to Joseph. In this new reality where he has lost everything, where he gets sold into slavery, where he is now an alien, a stranger, where nobody cares that he's his daddy's favorite, and nobody is asking him about his dreams, what in the world does Joseph have left? Just one thing, just one truth. There is this refrain that we see all through the Joseph story. We read it over and over again, and the Lord was with Joseph. Next week, we'll read about Joseph as a slave in Potiphar's house, but there's this same line, and the Lord was with Joseph as he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. And then the third week, we'll look at Joseph in prison. But then there's this line again, while Joseph was in prison, the Lord was with him. Now, something very strange happens to people in times of difficulty and loss. Somehow, they find God there. I have seen this over and over again, and it's not just that God is there to protect and provide somehow. God uses all the pain, all the unfairness, all the loss for a greater good. Somehow it gets redeemed. Now, that doesn't mean that we're glad bad things happen to us. That doesn't mean we shouldn't try as best we can to right the wrongs that we see around us. That doesn't mean we don't fight injustice, but it does mean that there is nothing that God cannot use. This past week, I was supposed to be at a worship conference in Nashville. It, like everything else, was moved online. One of the speakers at the conference was a lady by the name of Johnny Erickson Tata. Some of you will know that name. As a young woman, Johnny had an accident. She dove into a shallow part of the Chesapeake Bay, and she hit her head on the bottom, shattering her spine. And she came floating to the surface, unconscious and head down. She was swimming with her sister. Unfortunately, her sister was looking the other way when it happened, and she didn't see Johnny under the water. Right at that moment, her sister was bitten on the toe by a blue crab, and she hollered out in pain. She turned to Johnny, and that's when she saw her sister floating. And she pulled Johnny out, and she saved her life. Though Johnny was alive, she was also paralyzed from the neck down, and she never regained full mobility. Johnny is now 70. She has been in a wheelchair for 53 years, over half a century. Johnny shared with us at the conference how every single day she wakes up wishing that she could walk or run or swim again. She talked about the constant physical pain that she is in. She told us about how much hardship she's had to endure from others who didn't know how to respond to her situation or perhaps said something hurtful. But then she said that she has met God through that wheelchair in ways that she never could have without. In some strange way, in some way that you and I will never be able to understand, Johnny thanks God for that chair. It's almost impossible for us to imagine. I don't know why this or that has happened to you. When it comes to suffering and pain, there are simply no easy answers. But here's the promise: God will be with you through it no matter what, and God will use that hardship in ways that you cannot possibly imagine. Maybe what you're going through right now is a crushing loss, or maybe things are just a little more difficult than usual. Whatever the case, God is with you. God knows, God sees, God cares, and believe it or not, God is at work. Let us pray. And now, Heavenly Father, there are people listening who need your touch. There's sadness and discouragement and fear and uncertainty over the future. God, would you come alongside us now? And just as you were with Joseph in the pit, just as you were with Joseph as a slave, just as you were with Joseph in prison, be with us now. Assure us that we are never alone. God, thank you that in Jesus we have such hope. Amen. And now let us affirm what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us come before the Lord with our joys and concerns. Let us pray. We praise and glorify you, Lord God, for Christ is risen and conquered sin and death. He has broken the chains that bind us and has freed us to live in his kingdom of light. We thank you for the freedom that we have in you. And we thank you for the invitation to come to you when we are weary and carrying heavy burdens, knowing that we can cast our cares upon you. We are burdened by our worries and fear. Help us to know the joy of following you. We are burdened by the cares of the world. We pray for nations and leaders of nations, that there may be peace and justice for all people in all places. We are burdened by the thoughts of conflict and war. Reconcile enemies as brothers and sisters and protect our soldiers serving far from home. We are burdened by the needs of the poor. And so we pray for the hungry, that they may hunger no more, and that you might use us to do your work and bring about your will. And finally, we are burdened by the needs of those who are sick or in the hospital. We pray for those whose names you have put on our hearts, that they may know your healing power. As Labor Day is behind us and our schedules begin to fill up, help each of us to resist the temptation to give in to hurry and busyness. Instead of filling our lives with frantic activity, help us to enter your rest. Help us to stop trusting in our own work, Lord, and let you take over every aspect of our lives. Keep us from trying so hard in our own strength that we fail to trust you. Help us to see you in the many ways that you come to us, how even now you are renewing us, how you are making us whole again, how you are strengthening our faith that we may walk in the center of your will. And now hear us as we offer the prayer that Christ taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, being part of something that's larger than ourselves gives life meaning and helps us to connect with God in significant ways. And so let the gifts that we offer this week, not only our finances, but also our lives, serve others and meet needs, both near and far. And now as this service ends, go with God's blessing and the assurance that Christ is with you no matter what. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be kind and gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace, both now and forever. Amen.